Welcome to the first session of marketing management. This is paper code BM555, and the first session we are going to develop an understanding of what marketing concept is all about. Before we go any further, I would like to tell you that in today's present time where we are striving, it is very hard not to overstate the importance of marketing. From all those hot new stores that have come up to all those ongoing local stores, anybody can benefit with increased sales and heightened brand awareness with the help of a right marketing campaign. Simply put, I can say that if you are not marketing, you are not making progress. Also, we can say that no matter how good your product is in today's time, if you are not making the right marketing effort, you are simply standing where you are and you are being ignored by your customers. Rather, what is needed at this point of time is to move ahead, find out your clientele and to understand them. This subject, this session is going to progress through a series of learning outcomes. In this, we are going to go from introduction to learning the historical background of marketing, how the marketing role has enhanced in the business organizations today, the various definitions, the functions and scope of marketing managers, the core concepts associated with the definition of marketing, marketing management orientations, the difference between segment marketing and the challenges. Let's move ahead and answer one of the most important questions, which says that why a paper on marketing or why marketing as a discipline is important to all of us. Simply stating, it plays a major role in the society. Not only does it provide various career opportunities, but it affects almost all the shades of our life on a day-to-day basis. Also, it is one of the most vital business functions in any organization, which affects the business's survival, profits and goals. The first topic in this lecture tries to give you an introduction of how marketing evolved. What is the historical background of marketing? As humans, we have various needs. The needs that we are aware about today are magnified, not only in variety but also in magnitude. As against in the older times, man was largely dependent on others only for two things, which was food and shelter, most of which he could avail himself either by hunting or by collecting or by growing. But as the time flew by, his needs became more prominent and he was no longer a self-sufficient person, and therefore he went dependent on others. What happened was he started looking up to others for things that, that others had. For example, if I am consuming wheat, there may come a time when I don't want to consume fish or say a chicken, and if I do not have it, I am naturally dependent on some other person. It is here that the barter system came in, the single mode of exchange. In the barter system, a fisherman would exchange his fishes for a sack of wheat from a farmer. However, this system had its own demerits. The first one was, it was very difficult to find out another person who has absolutely the same type of product that a person needs, and that too in the required quantities. And second, there was a system of discrepancy in the equivalency. One sack of wheat was equal to how many cows or how many fishes. That was the problem. It was here that the introduction of a medium called money was introduced. As money came in, the markets, the geographical places started to engage in activities of selling goods and services in return of money. Everybody started to produce more so that they could earn more money from the market, which in turn would help them to obtain what they required with the money that they had. This gave birth to something which is known as markets, geographical places where buyers and sellers meet and they exchange goods with goods in return of money. As against the earlier times when they were exchanging goods for goods, now they started exchanging goods for money. The excess items that were being sold in the market made markets very competitive. The producers started to meet the buyers directly. They started to offer more and a variety of products to the buyers so that the buyers could buy from them. This, however, resulted into problem of sharing of time between production and selling. Now the farmers who were earlier engaged only in the cultivation part or the production part, were now distributing their time equally into engaging into the selling activities, which gave them a little time congestion. In order to get over this, they introduced specialist sellers. These were the people who were known as the middlemen, who were actually not involved or engaged into the cultivation or the production process, but were rather more involved in the process of getting this this production available to the buyers. The focus thus shifted to sales, retaining the customers and finding new customers. Selling could not be done without really understanding what needs and wants the customer have. Therefore, it was realized that one of the most important cornerstones is a customer. And thus, this gave rise to what is a customer-oriented approach, an approach which converted businesses into marketing organizations. This, in total, is just a glimpse of how marketing has changed shades over the period of time. One of the most important things to understand at this juncture would be to realize that marketing is not the whole and sole responsibility of the commercial organizations only, organizations which are involved in profit generation. At the same time, all those non-profit organizations, for example, I mentioned it, organizations such as temples or church, even they indulge into marketing efforts. How? Say, for example, a temple or a church provides their service, which is the product in this case, to its congregation, who are their customers, people who come to pray. It announces its activities, so it tells that it is going to have a Sunday mass, or it tells that it is going to have a special Christmas Eve prayer meeting to its congregation, who is the target market. It depends on the funds which the congregation provides in the form of fees to be, you know, a part of the member of the church, or any donations or charity that they make for its survival. Further, it is located where this congregation can have easy access, which is the place where they can come to pray on a regular basis. Therefore, customers would be the most important element of any marketing organization. We need to understand that in order to strike successfully into the market, we need to have satisfied customers. Thus, no customers may mean no business. Just now, we've been talking about, you know, meeting a buyer and a seller meeting at a place where they exchange goods, either in return of money or as in the earlier barter system, they were exchanging them for goods itself. This particular slide helps us understand what a simple market system looks like. Here, we see that there is a collection of sellers who are meeting with a collection of buyers. If you see that the seller has to offer products and services to the buyer, and the buyer in turn provide money to the seller. If at all a person is not interested in buying anything from the seller, it does not mean that the company and the buyer cannot communicate. You know, so for example, I may be needing a car, so I may go about into the market to find out how many sellers are there who are providing cars at this point of time. But then, if I do not need a car right now, I may need so in future. Therefore, a company must realize this and constantly engage in some communication effort with me, so that they are at the top of my mind recall. And any day in the future, when me, myself, or some of my known person would want a car, I should be having sufficient information to divulge, or I should be having enough information to react and quickly go out and find about this particular seller who has communicated with me in the past. On the other hand, companies are very much interested in today's time to find out how the market feels about them in terms of the quality of the products, in terms of the services they are rendering, in terms of what the competitors are doing, are they better, or the companies need to make certain changes in their existing models already. They constantly look forward to information from the market in the form of feedback. This is a simple market system. In addition, a number of people can be seen here. You know, can be put in here which are not put right now. Industry, where is a collection of sellers? For example, if you are talking about the automobile industry, there is Maruti, there is Honda, there is Hyundai, there is Ford, there is Volkswagen. So if right now we are talking about Maruti, Maruti would be the seller, and all the others, Honda, Hyundai, Volkswagen, would be the competitors. So there is a presence of competitors who are seen in here. In addition to this market, who is a collection of buyers, there is a group of people also who is a general public or the society. They may not be needing it right now, but they are still dependent on this industry, say either for employment, or there may be suppliers who may be supplying to this industry. Therefore, this market system is a very simple market system where we are trying to just So seller is here, all the others who are in the same industry may be here. At the same time, there may be a supplier who is supplying to both of them. For example, you are looking forward for somebody who can provide you furniture. So there are various sellers into the market. The one who you are buying from, say seller A is here and seller B, C, D are here. Both of them are looking forward to some supplier to have wood or say varnishes or say adhesives. These people, they form the supplier category. Once the goods are manufactured, in order to make them reach the end consumer, they are dependent on somebody who is known as the middleman. The intermediaries, who are the distributors, who take possession of the goods from these and make it available to the end consumers. This is again a very simplistic picture at this stage, which helps us to understand that these are some of the major parties who will be engaged in the marketing efforts in the long run. However, as we will progress, we will see that many people are added into this activity chain. This slide helps us understand that though marketing in itself has emanated from just a small mole to a big hill, at the same time within organizations also, the organizational authorities have realized that marketing indeed plays a major role. If we try to understand this figure, it's a five circle figure which helps us understand how the role of marketing has magnified. If you just pay attention, this blue highlighted area talks about the role of marketing. Let's look at the first figure. It says that out of the four broad functions which are conducted in any organization, production, finance, HR and marketing, every function is expected to play a major role. Therefore, they have been given equal opportunities. As the time progressed, the businesses realized that the markets are developing, the consumers are becoming a little educated, and therefore they are asking questions. And thus, a separate group of people is required who may be available all the time to deal with these customers. Therefore, slightly more importance was given to marketing function. As the time progressed further, it was realized that customers in themselves are the most important being, and they require a person whole and solely devoted to dealing with their issues and expectations. And thus, marketing was given the center stage. It became the major function, with all the others playing supplementary role. The time didn't stop there. We then further progressed and came in here, where marketing again took a side role and customer was given the major importance in the organization. It was here that for the first time it was realized that if you want to be there into the market for a long run, you need to pay attention to the customer, who's one of the most important fundamental stone for your successful organization. Later on, in the present time, it was understood that it is not just important to realize that customer is a controlling factor, it is also important to realize that the customer will remain intact with you only if marketing department plays the role of an integrated function. How it would be done? Rather than having customer-centric approaches, it was important to realize that it is time to play customer-oriented approaches. Everything generates from him and everything converges from him. Therefore, marketing was again given the central role, but at the same time, customer came at the heart of the organization. Thus, customer satisfaction, customer surpluses and customer delight became the most important objectives that organizations today are striving for. This five-stage diagram helps us understand how organizations have developed from being a seller's market to today's buyer's market. How buyer here was virtually given no importance and how here he has come to acquire the center stage. How a no customer policy has converted itself to become a customer oriented approach. This perhaps can be one of the most important figures which will help us understand the modern marketing concept. As we move further, we try to see how the traditional marketing role has changed and become an integrative modern marketing concept. If marketing in itself is so important. We need to understand what are the various principal angles marketing is trying to touch upon. Two of the most important ones are written here. The first one is profit, which yes, is an objective every organization is striving to achieve. But then they say that a one-way focus or a unidirectional approach with earning profits at the cost of the others may be an illegitimate goal. And therefore comes the second important word, which is customer satisfaction. The modern day marketing definition simplistically put says that marketing is the delivery of customer satisfaction at a profit. Understanding the importance of customer, giving him what he expects at the right time, at the right place, in the right quantity and at the right price will help us earn profit and to stay in the market for a long term. The smallest possible definition for marketing can be meeting needs profitably. The needs of the customer so that a win-win situation is developed. It can easily be understood that in today's time, in today's competitive time, in today's hard time, where there is a stiff cutthroat competition going on, where the number of sellers have increased to many fold, where the customer has become very smart, very sophisticated, very calculative, very demanding, the major focus of business is customer and customer centric. Thus, the two main goals of marketing in today's time can be to attract new customers by promising superior value and to keep the current customers by delivering satisfaction. Simply put, add customers and retain the original ones. That is the main goal of marketing. At this stage, it is important to understand one basic fact. There is a strong misconception amongst students when they mistakenly use marketing as a synonym for selling. Let's understand that marketing and selling are different. Is marketing selling? No. Marketing is not at all selling, because selling in itself simply means to say. Whereas marketing is an effort, is an exercise which helps you to enhance your sales. Marketing aids sales. Marketing plays a supportive role, marketing plays an enhancing role, marketing plays an incremental role in the life of selling. Here, selling begins only after your product is ready to be made available to the market, to the consumers. Whereas marketing, it starts long before the company even has the first prototype of a product. It begins from the day the company starts thinking of coming into the market. It begins from the day the company starts thinking of the target market they are expecting to reach out and serve. Marketing involves the homework to assess needs, measure the extent of these needs, and determine whether a profitable opportunity exists in the market. See, I might have said that profit in itself may be an illegitimate goal, but then going into the market well prepared and identifying your survival and growth chances is not an unethical practice. Therefore, one has to go into the market only by after making sufficient calculations as to a worthwhile profit exists into the market, an opportunity exists into the market, which will give you a long-term survival and stay into the market. On the other hand, marketing continues throughout a product's life. Finding new customers, improving your appeal, improving your performances, and managing repeat sales is an endless exercise. Sales, if A sells a product to B, the sales effort is complete and it may not cross over or it may not take a loop. Anything that happens after the product is sold is known as the after sales. And after sales is one exercise which is a part of marketing. Let's look at the first and the most comprehensive definition of marketing. There is a group of thinkers who have various angles to who have offered various angles to look at what marketing is. But this definition given by Philip Kotler in his Millennium Edition is perhaps the most comprehensive of all definitions. It says that marketing is a societal process value with each other. This definition is important because for the first time, the word societal has been introduced here. It is important because it talks of customers not only in the singular form, but also in the form of groups. It is important because it talks of a word like want rather than talking of the word need. And this definition is also important because it helps us understand that the scope of product which is being offered into the market is not just limited to goods, but the offerings have a plethora of products which can be offered into the market. And finally, yes, value, which I said that as soon as the barter system was replaced, the value system came in. The amount of money that a customer finds worthwhile to be departed to avail a product. At the same time, the most reputed association on marketing, the AMA, American Marketing Association, says that marketing management is the process of planning and executing the conception, pricing, promotion and distribution of ideas, goods and services to create exchanges that satisfy individual and organizational goals. Again, as comparison to the other earlier definition, which was just a definition of marketing, this is the definition of marketing management, a process of planning, organizing and directing the marketing effort. And while we are planning, organizing and directing the marketing effort, typically we are thinking about what the product would be like, what its possible price would be, how we are going to promote it into the market, and how we are going to make it available for distribution into the market. This is what marketing management is all about. Again, at the end, yes, all of this is done with one thing in mind, and that is to satisfy individual and groups who are availing your product and services. Before we go further to do a diagnosis, a closer diagnosis of the definition, it is rightful at this stage if we understand what are the various tasks or functions that a marketing manager has to perform. It clearly says that marketers are those people who are the sensory organ of a company, who are in the closest touch with the customer. They are the sensory organs in the sense that they sense and identify and report any changes that are observed on the customer front. At the same time, they can also act as the consumer's voice within the firm, and marketers are responsible for many other functions and not just advertising or sales. The first thing that they have to do is they have to assess the opportunities which are there in the market. For example, if a fast food joint is deciding to come in a small city like say Udaipur, then they have to identify which is going to be the most possible location where the footfall is very high. Is it going to be the common places where the youth goes, or whether it is going to be into a mall where families regularly visit, say for other purposes like shopping for grocery or shopping for clothes, etc., or whether it is going to be into a place which is far away from the city, so there are no problems related to traffic and parking, etc. That is one possible activity which is done here in assessing opportunities. The second one is once you have decided that you are going to make a particular type of product, you have to select your target market which you need to enter, whether it is going to be national or whether it is going to be international. At the same time, it is important to understand that marketing is not just about entry, marketing is about respectable departures as well. So if there are certain areas where your product is not doing good, and after assessing your marketing position, you have realized that things are not into your favor, it is also about making exit from the market. The third important thing that marketers are vested with the responsibility is to conduct research. Research gives you information, research gives you data, which will help you to take several decisions. Decisions of being there in the market, decisions to grow and expand your operations into the market, decisions to move back from the market or divest your money. Such will depend on, will be good if they are based on statistical data that you have collected from the market through consumer research. The last and the most important decision, important function that marketers are required to perform is to develop a marketing mix. This we will come on slightly later in this part of the lecture, where we talk about the four important ingredients which make up a marketing mix, namely product, price, place and promotion. Again, one of the most important things that we need to understand is that as the markets are growing, as the consumer consumers are becoming more demanding as the business, the scale of business operation is also increasing. The types of offering that are there into the market for us to make use of have also increased. Let me tell you, we are into a revolutionary phase where it's not just goods, physical goods and services which are available in the market, but there are even brides and grooms which are being marketed through matrimonial site. So if today anybody wants to get married, you do not need to go about the traditional way of looking for prospective brides and grooms. There are matrimonial sites where you can go find out specific brides and grooms belonging to your culture and your races. This slide helps us understand that everything is being marketed in the marketplaces. Like if you want to go for tourist destinations like Udaipur, Goa, Incredible India, Malaysia, Truly Asia, or say Taj Mahal, properties, say again, hotels, Oberoi Villas, or say Club Mahindra Resort destinations, organizations, RN Old Sinha University is an organization, hospitals in the form of Apollo or Fortis, goods, again, this is the most traditional type of entity which is available in the market in the form of a pen, pencil, or a car. Services, if you are trying to avail services of a teacher, or say a doctor, or if you are appointing an advocate who may, may present it to you into a court hearing, that are services. Experiences, if you go for a theme park, if you want to go for, say, Imagical Park in Mumbai and enjoy those rides and all, you don't get to bring any of those rides home, but then you have an experience which carries on with you. Say, if you have attended a concert of any pop singer, that's an experience you bring back, information. So, there are various sites like Google and Wikipedia who provide you information if you want to develop your understanding about a particular industry or say about a particular phenomena or a person. This information is available there. Ideas, if you go to a say a Vastu Salakar, or if you go to an interior decorator and ask them how your house should be built, what its innovation should be like, they give you ideas. Events, if you are attending a New Year's party, or if you are attending a Christmas party, or if you are going on, to attend a month, an IFA event, they are events. And finally, persons. So the classic examples would be the actors or the actresses in the entertainment industry, or say, all those politicians who are marketing themselves and trying to put their point across both to you so that you may give them votes, or you may go to the theatres to watch their movie. They are all trying to market themselves in one way or the other. This slide helps us understand that marketing in the true sense is all pervasive. There is no nook and corner of a life which is untouched by marketing. Almost everything is covered down in this particular slide. The definition that we have just learned in two slides back, where we were talking about some of the important parts of marketing definition, the coming slide will help us understand the five core concept which helps us in developing a marketing definition. This figure helps us understand that the five important elements that make up a marketing definition are, beginning clockwise, the first one is needs, wants and demands. We go to products, services and experiences which will satisfy these needs, wants and demands. In order to avail these products and services, we will need to have money in the form of value with us, and it should give us satisfaction. This money has to be exchanged with the products and services which are available with the seller, and for this exchange to take place, we will have to go to the markets. Let's see them in a little detail. The first important element of the definition was needs and wants. One should understand that we have progressed in time. Need is the basic state of deprivation. Food, clothing and shelter are the three most basic need that a person may have. Human needs, as they grow, they become complex. For example, you may need cloth, but then you may need a cloth which is of a particular quality. Social needs of belongingness and affection also comes in. There are needs of security, there are needs of esteem, there are needs of self-actualization. But then need in itself is the most basic concept through which the concept of marketing has originated. It is the basic state of deprivation. Simplistically, we can call it हर कस्टमर की अपनी जरूरत होती है. As we progress, we go to the word wants. Now wants are the basic stages being converted into specific form. So while one may be hungry and may want food, in a want segment, a person wants a double cheeseburger. Okay, and that burger should also come out of a MACD. Therefore, the destination and the address is clearly specified. This want is shaped by the culture, the locality, or the individual's personality, and therefore they are different. Two people coming from the same family of the same gender, whereas one child may be a person who prefers vegetarian food, the other child may prefer non-vegetarian food. The one child may prefer something which is homemade, the other child may always want to buy something which is coming out of a restaurant. Therefore, wants are specific, wants are clear. It is important to realize that people have almost unlimited wants but limited resources. The funny part is, this is where the role of marketing actually becomes more profound. Rather, I can say that the resultant of marketing is this unlimited wants. Finally, there is something like an economic terminology which is known as demand. The good part is, demand will be demand only when what a person wants is backed by money. If money is not there, that want is of no use to the economics. But for marketers, it is very, very important that a person should be raised from that basic level of need to that higher order of want, where if a product is not made available to him or her, may create unrest in the life. Simplistically, all those offerings which are available into the market can be broadly classified into two categories, products and services. The basic difference is anything which can be seen, touched and possessed is a product. It is a tangible commodity and therefore it is also known as a physical object or a materialistic object. On the other hand, services are intangible. They are the ones which cannot be seen or which cannot be touched, but they can only be felt. So all your experiences, all your satisfaction levels would be coming down here. Again, it is important to understand that services cannot be owned. They are short time span. Once paid and consumed, they are over. Whereas in the case of a product, you get to keep and retain the product, stock it for at least some point of time. The third important element of this definition is value, satisfaction and quality. The three terms are related to each other and they are often seen as brothers and sisters. See, value is a customer's estimate of what a product is worth for. It is the amount of money that the customer is ready to depart with in order to gain access to the product. It says that it's a perceived value. So every customer may have a different perception. For one customer, a product may be expensive, whereas for the other, it may be economic, whereas for the third one, it may be just alright. The second term is satisfaction, a very important term in marketing. A satisfied customer is said to be one of the most important accomplishments of a marketing organization. They are those people who will end up buying your product and will have a positive feedback about it. These are the ones who are expected to engage into a repeat purchase. The third one is a quality. It is a customer satisfaction's a customer satisfaction is directly linked with a parameter called quality. It is a customer's estimation of how useful or utilitarian a product is. So higher the usefulness of the product, higher the utility of the product, the more is the quality of the product. It can also be said that a product's performance is directly related to its quality, and it can also be said that a quality means freedom from any kinds of defects. The last and the most important concept in the definition of marketing is exchange, transaction and relationships. One needs to understand that the basic way of getting hold of a product from the market is through exchange, which is giving mine and taking yours. If this barter system is not prevalent, then we can jump onto the second one, which is a transaction, where two parties can exchange good at a pre-decided place for a pre-planned amount that may have been accepted by both the parties. But what is important at this stage is, if we have been saying that customer is one of the most important pillars in the entire marketing organization, would it not be better if we can have a long-term relationship with him? If we can earn his patronage, if we can earn his support, if we can get him to be a part of our family? And that is where relationships come in. It says that it is a process of creating, maintaining and enhancing strong value-related relationships with customers and other stakeholders, thus giving them a long-term sustainable relationship with the company, practicing ethical codes, following the codes of conduct, and giving them not only valuable products but also giving them quality products. At this stage, we need to understand that what marketing is today, it was not always so. Or we can say that not all the organizations were equally enthusiastic about marketing. Marketing took time to come in, marketing took time to settle in, but now that it has taken the front seat, it is here to stay for a long time. The coming slides will help us understand what are the different philosophies that organizations have towards the role of marketing. It will also help us understand that different organizations have different orientations towards marketing. There are some who say that marketing is very important, whereas there are others who say that the other aspects of marketing are important as well. Let's go ahead. The role that marketing plays within a company varies according to the overall strategy and philosophy of each firm. There are broadly five alternative marketing concepts that organizations prefer to follow. They can be seen like this, going clockwise, starting from the first one, the production concept, jumping on the second one, which is the product concept, the third one is the selling concept, fourth is the marketing concept, fifth is the cycle concept. As we speak, more of the concept may be developing. One of the most important ones that I've heard of is the experiential concept. Let's take them up each one by one. The first one, production concept, a simple philosophy where the company believes in one thing, and that is to make more and more production so that mass production would lead to low unit per cost and thus help in developing affordable products for the consumers. At the same time, they say that if a company is engaged in the production of a singular product, then the chances of developing goods with efficiency are also higher. Therefore, the focus here in this particular concept was to develop more affordable products by engaging in mass production. Came the second one, which is known as the product concept. As the consumers became more smart, they realized that all of them do not need the same type of product. For example, in the production concept, say a company manufacturing toothpaste was just manufacturing a singular type of a toothpaste into the market, a white cream which was available for cleaning the teeth. But then as the consumers realized that they have a different requirement, either in the form of the flavor that they are looking forward to, or in the consistency that they are looking forward to, or in the form of the particular ingredients that they are expecting from the product, the company had to listen to what the consumers wanted, and not in the total sense of listening, but the companies realized that if the competition is getting so stiff, in order to stay there into the market, we would have to work on the fronts of providing better and innovative features into our product. And came the product concept. It says that consumers will favor only those products which offer the most quality, performance and innovative features. And thus came a toothpaste which said that it has got clove oil, came the other one which said that this is a gel based one, and came the other one which said that our toothpaste is available in different sizes as well. That was it. Once this concept was there into the market, after a certain point of time, the companies felt that the consumers are not buying until and unless a rigorous effort is being followed with them. This philosophy helps us understand that the idea that consumers will not buy enough of the organization's product until the organization undertakes a large-scale selling and promotion effort. So in this particular concept, in this particular orientation, the companies started shifting their focuses to developing sound marketing promotion programs, of engaging in advertising, of engaging in sales promotions, so that a consumer would find a particular trigger because of which he or she may be attracted, or because of which he or she may be compelled to go and take a product from the market. But then this selling concept also did not provide a long-term solution to the marketing problems, and thus we came into the most revolutionized form of markets, where the sellers realized the importance of developing a special approach to get across the customers, serve them, and make them stay with themselves. And that is what is known as the marketing concept. This concept enunciates that the idea that the social and economic justification for an organization's existence is the satisfaction of customer wants and needs while meeting organizational objectives. We need to understand three things very clearly. An organization will continue to exist only when they provide satisfaction to the customers for his wants and needs. But then this should be done keeping in mind the organizational objectives of profit or survival or sustenance, and at the same time understanding that there is a group of people who are indirectly connected to our organization in the form of a society, and that their welfare is also a prime concern for the organization's survival. The modern day marketing concept looks like this. The marketing concept is based on three fundamental aspects, and the three aspects are customer orientation, integrated effort, and goal achievement. It says that everything should start up from customer and end up with customer. Customer satisfaction is important. As a matter of fact, customer delight is important. It is not just enough in today's time if you are able to satisfy your customer. You need to develop effort which surprise him, which delight him, which takes him one step ahead and makes him really happy to be a part or associated with you. The second one is an integrated effort. It helps us understand that marketing is not an activity which is reserved for the marketing department. It is a collaborative effort where all the departments need to come in and they should work in tandem, so that the customer satisfaction is resulted. And finally, goal achievement. Whether it is about the broad organizational goal, or whether it is the divisional goal, or whether it is the individual departmental goal, all should understand that it should come via customer satisfaction. Therefore, the modern day marketing concept helps us understand that organizational goals are to be achieved by identifying and determining what the target market wants and delivering the same to them in an effective manner, better than the competitors, and earning customer satisfaction. This slide is very important, and it helps us develop a clear understanding as to how selling and marketing are different. If you see the first arrow, it helps us understand how the selling concept progresses, whereas the bottom one helps us understand how the marketing concept progresses. If you see there, the selling starts in the factory, whereas marketing starts from the market. And as I have just told you at the beginning of this particular session, market here refers to the group of the customers. Therefore, whereas selling starts with in the company, this is an outward approach, it starts from the market. In the selling, whereas the focus is on the existing products, here the focus is on the customer needs. earn the profit through sales volume which are sold into the market. Here, if you remember, I just told you that an integrative effort is required, where a company, after asking the consumer what he or she needs, conceive a particular product, price it appropriately, promote it to the right customers at the right time, and finally place it so that it is comfortably and conveniently available to the customer. That is what the integrated effort is, developing the product and finally earning profits through customer satisfaction. If we see, that one is just an approach where you are making it and selling it. Whereas here, just before making it and selling it, we are engaging into something which is known as asking. So this is a simple exercise of make and sell, and this one is ask, make, tell and sell. So it is very clear that in the bottom one, we are trying to engage the customer at every step. It is his needs and requirements which are at the forefront. We are asking him what he or she wants, and we are making it as per his desires. If not 100% as per his desire, we are just trying to make it in a format which is going to be most acceptable to him. At the same time, if you see, it helps us understand the various orientations. From the production concept, we jump to product, we jump to selling, we jump to marketing, and we are still to engage ourselves into learning what societal marketing concept is. It is a new generation word where companies have learned to realize that they are a part of a larger super system, where apart from the suppliers and the stakeholders and the distributors and the customers, there is still a segment of people to whom we have a responsibility towards. And that group of people can be referred to as the society or the public. Those people who are either not consuming what you are making, or who can either not consume but still they have a right to live by without getting affected by the practices that you are engaging in. I do not mean to say here that almost all the practices that we engage in are unethical, but then if somehow say somebody has a factory which through which a certain amount of chemical flows out into the vicinity, and say it is some chemical remains which are thrown out into the nearby rivers or nearby say lakes, then the people who may be living by may be affected by it. So this society is also not to be neglected or ignored. We have a certain responsibility towards them, which is depicted in here. It says that the idea that the organization should determine the needs and wants and interests of the target market and deliver the desired satisfaction more effectively and efficiently than the competitors, in a way that it maintains or improves not only the consumers but the society's well-being as well. In the beginning, I somewhere mentioned that a one-side mindset on earning profit may be an illegitimate goal for an organization. But if we engage into a win-win relationship, a mutual relationship where the others also get benefited by our acts, is where I actually meant to be talking about something like this, a social welfare or a society welfare. This is somewhere one has to realize that there is a group of people for which you have to constantly engage into activities which is going to make life better for them also. This particular figure will help us understand that there are three considerations that marketers need to pay attention to. A society, who includes the public or talks about human welfare, the company, who's interested into its profit, and consumers, for whom we are working for their need satisfaction. So at the three principal angles, a company should work with a three-pronged strategy: earning profits, full satisfaction, and providing human welfare at the same time. How this can be done? I've just tried to enlist a few. You know, you can engage into this activity by providing or developing less toxic products. You can make products which are more durable, or you can make products which are reusable or which are recyclable, or you can make products which are less detrimental to the environment, so on and so forth. At this stage, it is also very important to understand the concept of marketing myopia introduced by Theodore Levitt. He said that, often businesses, they become over-obsessed with any one factor in the organization. Either they become obsessed with the products that they are manufacturing and selling, or they become obsessed with the type of production procedure they are engaging into, or they sometimes become obsessed with the territory in which they are selling their product. And this actually stops their development. This stops them from rising up, growing and developing or expanding their operations into other areas also. Simply put, Theodor Levitt said that marketing myopia is a narrow-minded approach. It is a crooked vision. It is a distorted mentality of a marketer where he or she tries to sell more and more products into the market without paying any attention to what the customer actually needs and wants. This is also known as marketing short-sightedness, where the entire focus shifts onto the product rather than on what the customer needs and wants. Therefore, we can say that marketing myopia is a sort of a kingdom, state where companies become possessive, obsessive about their products, and they do not care anything about the customer. The result is, in the short run, because there is no long run, in the short run, they would be wiped out of the market. Plenty of examples are there. Let's talk about what happened with Maruti's Gypsy, what happened with Maruti's 1000, what happened with the Tata Sierra, or what happened with the Kodak, the film cameras. Everybody, they were so obsessed with what they were making into the market that they were actually not paying attention to what the consumer wants. They did not rise up, they did not change as per the requirements of the customer, and resultantly they were wiped out. So the Kodak cameras were then replaced by the Sony's digital cameras. The same happened with your MSN Messenger. Although it was the first one into the market, they came into the market in 1999, but less than 5 years, their fame was wiped out by Skype. So Skype came with better features, better interface, where the consumer was the consumer found it more handy and more easy to use to. Several examples are there, but then in a nutshell, simply put, if you do not rise up, if you do not change yourself as per your consumer, you'll be wiped out from the market. A summarized form of all what we have learned, from the production to the sales to the marketing to the societal concept, the focus has shifted from what we can do best, how we can sell aggressively, to what the customer wants and how we can do this in an effective manner, at the same time benefiting the society. This is most important. Finally, let us come to understanding what are the important steps that needs to be followed in the marketing process. Of course, we have understood by now that marketing plays a vital role in an organization. Marketing is pivotal. Marketing is the backbone of a successful organization, and every organization with a sound marketing effort can have increased sales and can have a heightened brand awareness into the market. We need to understand what process needs to be followed. This slide up here, it helps to understand that there are four important steps that needs to be done. This in itself is a very important process. The first step is analyzing marketing opportunities and developing what is the mission, vision and objective of the organization. Second, selecting those target markets which you have the capability of serving more and better. Finally, developing the marketing strategy in the form of developing an integrated sound marketing mix, product, price, promotion, place, and finally managing the effort. Therefore, the four steps would be to analyze the opportunities, develop your mission and mission plan, develop the marketing mix, and finally manage this effort by emphasizing suitable control mechanisms. Out of all this, we shall discuss step 3 and 4 in detail in the coming lectures, but at this stage it is important to learn that for every organization to be there in the market, these are the four pillars on which the canopy of success of your marketing organization rests. A good product which is sure to provide solution to a consumer's problem, a place where he or she can conveniently and comfortably reach out and get access to the product. A price which is affordable to him, at the same time is profitable to you. And finally, a promotional campaign which gives their information at regular intervals and improves their awareness level as to what new and better products are being available into the market. To conclude this lecture, it would be important for us to understand that marketing is not having a good time all around. There have been several challenges which have been posed in and which have been popped from all the corners of the environment. Some of the most important ones I have enlisted in here. One of the most important challenge that marketing has to face was the development of the non-profit marketing. All those, as we have just discussed the example of all those temples and churches, of all those societies which are working for the betterment of people and which are not outwardly engaged into profit generating exercises, they all would come here. The second one has been the boom of the information technology, where just to buy a product which is available in America, you need not go to America. It is just a click away. So whereas in the traditional times, in order to get a product, we had to go to a brick and mortar shop, a physical place to buy a product. Today you can do so conveniently and easily by sitting in the confines of your home, just a click away. In the midnight at 2 o'clock, you can just open the laptop, log on to the sites, buy a product that you want, and say in less than 24 hours the product shall be dropped in at your place. That's the revolution that has been caused because of information technology, globalization. The world has become a common place. Now it's not that in the earlier times where there was only one shop in the entire city. Today we have more than 4 or 5 shops, and we do not even need shops where the products are available on the internet. You can just go and log on to the websites and buy the products from there. And finally, most important one, the increasing importance which is being assigned to ethics and social responsibility. We have just now seen the societal marketing concept, which says that at every point you cannot afford to ignore somebody who's known as your who's known as the general public. People have you have certain responsibilities to all those people who are not buying your products. You have responsibilities which you can discharge in the form of providing employment to them, which can impart by developing public parks or educational institutions or hospitals for them, so that it is not just the people who are directly giving you money would be benefited, but people around you would also be benefited from it. Finally, I would like to say that the past decade taught business firms everywhere a humbling lesson. Some of the most important learnings are: first, the domestic companies learned that they can no longer ignore global markets and competitors. Because if you are not going there, does not mean that they are not coming here. So when they are coming here, we need to be ready for them. We need to be proactively geared up, and we need to have a sound marketing effort which would be very much essential to fight them. The second important learning was, successful firms in mature industries learn that they cannot overlook emerging markets, technologies and management approaches. Being there, seeing that does not mean that now you're not required to do it. It means that you have a more increased responsibility of developing new and better ways of doing things. And third, companies of every sort learn that they cannot remain inwardly focused. Ignoring the needs of customers and their environment can be detrimental to your health. And therefore, you need to understand and pay attention to the customer and constantly engage into activities which will satisfy him and delight him. These are some of the references which will help you to develop a more better understanding of the things that we have just learned in this slide. I'll repeat once again. We developed an understanding of the historical background of marketing. We understood the definitions of marketing, the core concepts, the orientations that the companies are following, how the marketing role has emerged and how it has magnified. And finally, we were trying to understand what is the difference between selling and marketing. The next lecture that we will engage in, we'll take it straightforward and we'll try to understand the integrated marketing effort in terms of four pieces of marketing, that is marketing mix.